The following program is a production of the Fairfax Network, Fairfax County Public Schools.
Welcome to Community Keynotes. This program was recorded at the Fairfax County Public Schools' second annual Community Conversation on Teen Stress. Dr. Tracy Cross, Executive Director of the Center for Gifted Education and Talent Development at the College of William & Mary, was one of the keynote speakers at the event. He spoke on academic success and performance perfection among students, and the often resulting feelings of inadequacy and performance anxiety.
Given the topic and given that what we're going to do is really try to talk about the lives of our high ability kids in school, some things about them to help them do well, thrive, avoid some of the struggles that are very common these days. So we're gonna visit the real life of what it is to be a high ability kid. Now I will tell you, being a professor at College of William and Mary is kind of a good place to study this. And we have a fair number of studies going on as we speak. And while I like to laugh, and I do everything in my power to help others share that, I also have become arguably the only specialist in the world who studies the suicidal behavior of gifted children. Everybody's a child to me, so I should qualify that a little bit. Youth and adolescents, okay? So, my wife helped me yesterday. We went through and I tried to put together the best set of slides to help convey some important points, and hopefully this will help. Now let me start by saying a couple of things. One, I am a parent, I have four kids. That has clearly affected my view about some of the things we'll talk about, my views. Also, I'm a psychologist, so I commit psychology all the time, I can't help it. So there are other ways to consider some of these things, but my lens will be psychology for the most part. And I'm a researcher. We do a lot of research at our Center for Gifted Education and the School of Ed. So as we go on, if anything we talk about today is of interest to you and you'd like to get more information or touch base, follow up in any way, the last slide includes my email address. And I really would encourage you to follow up, because I spend the first 2 or 3 hours of the day just responding to email from people exactly like yourselves. I welcome this, because it's only been in the last 15 or so years that we've been able to communicate easily about the well-being of our children. And I like to help build networks. One of the reasons I come up here is to connect with you all and to try to help continue the development of the networks of parents, because for our kids to thrive, you know, we really need to bring to bear the resources that are available, and some of those are human resources. So please avail yourself of that. Now, I'm coming here specifically this time. I've been here 7 times under different hats, you might say, different topics. But this time we're in the context of the stress related to being a student in modern times. And one of the most important aspects to that is the context in which it is to be a student. And to be a high ability student brings to bear all sorts of, in many cases, unique experiences that other people can't and don't have. So these are the topics we'll cover, and then underneath them we'll provide some detail. So we're going to talk a minute or two about the context. In this case, the context of being in this school district proper, in this state, in the United States, in 2015. Okay? Those things all have bearing. First, what are our schools for? What are they meant to be? Now, I'm not going to answer this in a long philosophic way, but I am going to give you a little bit of information that I can tell you worries us in the U.S. Department of Ed. And that is that our schools serve a couple of major roles. One is, it's our primary institute for acculturating Americans from all backgrounds. So our schools are our country's institutions to bring everybody into an acculturative process to enable them to be a successful adult person. okay? That can mean employment, that can mean parenting, it can mean being a good civil student or a good civil adult. It has all sorts of different ways in which being an American plays out, and our schools help us get to that point. Now, I can tell you, being in Williamsburg, we're a relatively small town, and so this part of the state, Northern Virginia, when I was looking to move to come to William & Mary, people would talk to me a lot about Northern Virginia, and I didn't really know what that meant. But I would say that probably 30 or 40 people told me their views about Northern Virginia and what the context to them meant. And almost all of them described it in terms of being a very high-performing community that was made up of numerous communities. Fairfax County, Arlington, all these different communities were described to me and mentioned. And that the people who live in this community care a lot about the schooling, the education that their children get. Well, you know, that's very interesting. Those are very positive things to hear. They would go on to say that there's considerable pressure to do well in school, and that they do turn out very, very good students who go on and go to universities and catch the world on fire. Well, those are all very laudable and positive things, right? So I thought, well, this is great. I can't wait to move to Virginia and, you know, meet more people from this part of the state and so forth. So let's get a little deeper into this. We looked at the Fairfax County Strategic Plan, and this is an image that I thought was kind of cool. It's talking about four different areas of emphasis that are important, four things to emphasize: student success, premier workforce, resource stewardship, and a caring culture. So today I thought, well, we'll kind of limit ourselves to more of the student success and the caring culture because they fit our topic so well. All right, why are we here today? Well, this is the second annual event that's around this notion of teen stress. And again, teen stress has become a term that's used to mean a lot of things. So I thought, well, we'll provide some very specific details here to try to help this a little bit. All right, we looked at some research that's been being done here for several years. We were very appreciative to have access to that. And I pulled out three items that I'd like you to look at. Now again, we're still talking about setting the stage. This is contextual. So as members of our community here, according to the youth survey, 2011-2013, you'll see three items up there. And if you start with the highest mark there, the blue line, that was a question that asked students about feeling sad or hopeless. And the actual item was more like this: have you ever felt so sad or hopeless almost every day for 2 weeks or more in a row that you stopped doing some usual activities? Okay, so it wasn't like, are you generally sad or feeling somewhat hopeless? It was that you noted in yourself a fairly deep-seated sadness or hopelessness that has affected your behavior as a student and as a person. So that's a pretty significant indicator. And as a psychologist, you know, my ears perk up and I want to know a little bit more about that. And you'll notice the rate, it's been pretty consistent in those 2 years, right about the 30% mark. Now I hear there are like 185,000 students. I'm looking for confirmation. 185,000 students in this district, and about 30% of them, at least at this level, 8th, 10th and 12th graders, took this. And so that's a lot of kids. That's a lot of people who felt that way for that period. So if you drop down to the red line, the question pertained to basically, have you ever considered suicide in the time frame that they were asked about? And it's about 16-17% indicated that they had. Again, you want to say, okay, let's make note of that. Let's put that in the context here. What I'm trying to do by the end of the hour is create a mosaic image of your community as it pertains to these topics that we're talking about, okay? And then at the lowest mark, the yellow line, it looks like it's about 4-5% from 2011-13, students saying that they had, in fact, attempted suicide. So we've gone from a broad concept of hopelessness or deep sadness to considering suicide to attempting suicide. Now, are these numbers out of line with other places? Are they somewhat consistent? Why do they matter? Can we do anything with them? Those are all good questions. First, let me try to answer them a little bit, and then we'll get into some more detail. The bottom number, 45%, is a little higher than average, but not significantly so. The top number is a little bit higher than average, but not significantly so. The medium number, guess what? A little higher than average, but not significantly so. So, what I'm suggesting is that the environment in which her children go to school, this is representative for a couple of groups for a period of time, and that at least gives us a little bit of an image forming that being a student right now in these years, it's a tough time to be a student, it's a tough time to be a person. There are all sorts of things in our lives that create anxiety, and not all of them are even talked about. I'll give you the easiest one to realize, and yet it's one that we seldom talk about. Whenever our country, meaning the U.S., whenever the U.S. is at war, it elevates the anxiety floor for American citizens. Now, you could argue that it doesn't affect some Americans, and that's true, but for the most part, it affects Americans. It elevates the basic daily functional level of anxiety. Now, it doesn't just go away. It elevates it so that we then lead our lives with a slightly heightened level of anxiety. Well, that's important to know because anxiety tends to be one of those things that affects a lot of other experiences that we have. Levels of joy, feelings of depression, those two things are very much affected by anxiety. Other things, when we see an event on the news where there's been a bombing, say an attack in the Middle East, because of our experiences with 9/11 and other things that followed, when we see those events or we hear about them, we don't even have to see them. And they don't have to be specific to us in any way. Again, it has an effect on our anxiety. You can say that Americans have been put on an intermittent reinforcement schedule in anxiety. Does that make sense at all to you? Sometimes you just hear these things and you don't feel good all of a sudden. Or later in the day you realize, wow, that really made me sad when I heard that. So our children are in school and they're not oblivious to these things. And for this age group of kids we're talking about, the United States has been at war their entire lifetime. So they're a cohort in our history that's a little unusual that way. So they've lived their entire lives while we have been in one war or another. Now, for those of my generation, I can tell you that when the war was being characterized in the news back during Vietnam, it was very prevalent. It was on the news every day. There were certain things you saw about the war that kept it front and center. But in the subsequent wars, that's been changed quite a bit so that you don't see much. For example, you don't see soldiers being put in caskets. All that's been isn't shown to us anymore. So it's a different way of characterizing things. Okay, so we'll keep going. Okay, so we're willing to talk about student success, being a successful student, and this caring community concept. What does that mean? Is it important? Does it matter? Is it a waste of taxpayers' money? I want to remind you of two figures who will help us have this conversation, okay? One is named Eric Erickson. He's one of my very favorite psychologists. And the other is Yuri Bronfenbrenner. I imagine many of you can remember from your Psych 100 days those two names, at least I hope so. Eric Erickson was the first developmental psychologist to claim that people's development continued beyond age 4. My community used to think that we basically stopped developing as people when you were about 4 or 5 years old. And it took Eric Erickson to come along and say, no, you know, we actually continue to develop in certain ways across a lifespan. And that was very radical back in his day. Well, think about school-age children from kindergarten through 12th grade. According to Erickson, there are certain crises that we need to transcend in order to be healthy socially and emotionally. Now, he's known for psychosocial development. So I'm going to use this as a tool today to talk briefly about things like starting life with a basic trust or mistrust about humanity. And one of the things Erickson's work did was illustrate that for our newborns, those who get proper care, fed, regularly changed, held, those three things are the essential components. They seem to have a more positive worldview about humanity. And those that who don't get those aspects, in some cases, in rare cases, die. So it's very important in the early days to have that experience. First few years of life, children are, remember the terrible twos? What a nice title, terrible twos. So the we know that children's brains are wired such that when they're about 18 to 30 months, they are just little hellions, you know? They want to experiment with everything. They want to grab it, touch it, drag it, put it in their mouths, put their fingers in it, poke it, eat it. And that's the experiential aspect of learning that's so pronounced at that time. Supporting that as a family, as a parent, as a mother, as a father, creates a sense of autonomy. Dampening it down negates that. It creates this sense of shame. And it's really sad to see a young person affected that way when they're going through their natural experiential basis of becoming a full-blown person. Next, you're coming into early school days, 3 to 6 roughly. Again, initiative. They're now showing initiative in ways that are different than just experimenting with everything. And again, if families support it, in other words, Johnny wants to draw today, and he asks, can he get out the crayons and the paper, and he starts doing that. If he grows up in an environment that's supportive, children like that tend to have a great sense of that they can initiate things in their lives. And that's very important in life because it feeds into self-efficacy and other aspects of autonomy. If they don't, they create guilt. They feel guilty. It's hard to imagine a 5 or 6-year-old feeling guilty. But it happens, and it happens all the time, and we teach it. So continuing on, first grade about through 5th grade or 6th grade. One of the great things our schools do, if they did nothing but this, in my book, they would be winners. They help children learn industry. Our teachers, our elementary school teachers, are absolutely fabulous in teaching kids this notion of industry. What does that mean? It means that you as an individual person have it within your power to do things successfully. And how do they learn that? By cutting things, drawing things, gluing things, sticking things, things that are often simple tasks, the accumulation of those things. And of course, it gets more complicated the longer in school. It might be, very basic mathematics, and by the end of 5th or 6th grade, they might be in pre-algebra or algebra even. So that developmental interaction with success of industry creates a very strong foundation for things that follow in life, like agency, and I want to speak about that a bit. Now, the next stage will be the only one we go through from this point. We won't spend much time with the older adulthood, but Eric Erickson was first well known for his notion of identity formation. And you hear that talked about a lot, and some of his early research, in my opinion, was a little off the mark, and some of it was terrific. But the idea is that when children get to a certain awareness, they go through all sorts of issues of development in psychology of a psychosocial nature that might play out, manifest by like dating, friendship formation, things like that, things that are important. And the accumulation of these things along with nascent aspirations sort of start defining the person. How do you define yourself? I'll give you an example. American schools are really great for defining some children as athletes. A lot of our children come through our schools and over time develop an athletic persona, an identity of athletics. I think that's great. Some do it in academics. Some do it in other domains, I'll call them. So these kinds of crises being resolved, our schools are an essential component to them. And when kids have a fairly good shot at it, they do very well later in life. So let me move on. Uri Bronfenbrenner is known for this idea that there are different influences on people's development, and starting really closest to home, quite frankly, is the mother. And because part of it we've learned recently, since Bronfenbrenner's early theory, is in vitro, hearing the mother's voice, learning certain types of rhythms. And then other family members come into the fold over time, oftentimes before the baby's born. And then, of course, once the baby's born, then they're depending upon the family constellation and so forth, that tends to be the earliest influence. But then you have extended family, you have community, you have things within your communities, you have health services, you have all sorts of different concentric circles of influence on individuals. And they work their way out, so to speak, all in the backdrop of time. So growing up in Northern Virginia in the 2000s, by most American standards, would be a pretty privileged upbringing. Now, there are other places where maybe you would say, by comparison, that wouldn't be so. I'm not sure I could point those out. But you've got very fine schools. You've got communities that believe strongly in a good education. You've got relatively safe places to be, etc. So when you grow up and where you grow up are very important. I lived in Wyoming for a number of years, and Wyoming had no school larger than 1,500 students, and it only had one that had 1,500 students, and it had two that had 1,200 students, and then it dropped off. I did a study of all the people vying for valedictorian in all of the high schools in all of Wyoming between 10 in the morning and noon. I had all that data. So Wyoming, you grow up, you might be in a one-room schoolhouse in the year 2015, where maybe there are 15 or 20 students that cut across 12 grades. That still exists there. There are people's properties in Wyoming that are larger than the state of Rhode Island. There are at least three of those still. So where you live, where you grow up, the sensibilities, expectations, all become part of this culture that influences the identity formation, the sense of agency, identity, aspirations, and so forth of the children we're talking about. Stress. A state of mental or emotional strain or tension resulting from adverse or very demanding circumstances. Does that seem like a reasonable definition to you? Because, you know, we could have put in any of 20 more, but this one seemed kind of reasonable, I thought. Emotional strain or tension. Isn't that a neat looking slide? My wife put that together. Stress. You can feel that, can't you? I mean, just looking at that red and the black and the white, it feels stressful. So we showed some things that often are associated with stress in our children in school. Perceived pressures from peers. Multiple AP or IB courses. Perceived pressure from parents. Perceived pressure from teachers. Perceived pressure from other adults. Self-imposed pressure. These are just some of the categories of potential pressures. Now, the key word there is obviously perceived. You know why? Because if you don't perceive it, it doesn't affect you. And the other corollary, sometimes it's perceived when it's not there. My daughter, who I can promise you this is something we've known about for a long time, told my wife and me a couple years ago, "Well, you told me I had to make straight A's." I can promise you those words never came out of either of our mouths. What we actually said was, "We expect you to do your very best in school." Through her ears at that time, I guess she translated that, and that's what she internalized. That's what children do. Like, how imperfect is communication? I mean, you can't even answer that question, can we? How good is it within your family? We work hard at it in mine, and I swear I don't think two conversations in three, no one seems to understand what was being talked about. This issue of family communication ends up being the cornerstone of the process of helping kids thrive. I'm not taking it in the other direction. I'm saying it is the potential ameliorative force or agent for thriving if you create it and keep it going. All right, now I'm going to get specific. I want to talk with you briefly about perfectionism. Let me see if a show of hands here, if you don't mind. Have any of you ever met a person you would describe as somewhat perfectionistic? And for the rest of you, I'll wait for you to raise your hands too. They're all over, right? You can't shake a stick without finding someone who's perfectionistic. Is perfectionism always a bad thing? Is perfectionism possibly a good thing? Well, let's talk about it in some detail. We have better research on this than we used to. When I was a young person, our concepts around perfectionism were really unidimensional, not very thoughtful, and not empirically based. And now we're in a different place. So I want to share with you some research about perfectionism, and I'd ask you to think about your family. Think about your friends, your extended family. See what you think. This can be very powerful tools for you. I bet most of you are here, A, because you're concerned about the well-being of your children, whoever your children are defined as, students, literally your children. And B, you'd like to see them have a long, healthy, happy life. Can we agree on that? Now, how do you get there? Is there life for a parent after having a 13, 14, and 15-year-old daughter? Well, I don't want to say too much. You know, I'm still holding my breath, but my daughter is 21 now, and our life has changed significantly once she got out of her teens. It's amazing how much my wife and I learned from the time she was about 18 till 21. Parenting's hard. Teaching is hard. These kinds of details can be helpful to you. So a type of perfectionism is called self-oriented. This research is done earliest by a group called researchers named Flett and Hewitt. Hewitt and Flett. So they came up with three different types of perfectionism, not one type. We use this in our field quite a bit now. This person sets unusually high standards for themselves. It's internally driven. They tend to overcommit. They like to be in control, but you know, that describes a good portion of Americana, I would say. They're not satisfied with their work. Even when they're very successful at it, they're not satisfied with it. Sometimes they're not able to relax. Sometimes they're fidgety or they're wanting to work when they might be better suited to relax. Now here's a model that came from some data that attempts to show the various factors that seem to influence this type of perfectionism, okay? Parental influences. Now, that doesn't literally mean parents. Sometimes it's parents, sometimes it's guardians, sometimes it's grandparents. It's the adult people who provide the day-to-day supervision for the children. What type of parenting style would you describe them as being? Well, for this kind of perfectionism, they tend to be authoritative. Are you familiar with that concept of parenting? An authoritative parent tends to have very high expectations for their children. But they also tend to be relatively communicative and, I would say, affirming emotionally. So when they have a dialogue in their family, it's a dialogue, it's not a monologue. Okay, the other side of that, the person tends, oftentimes, one of the parents or adults is a perfectionist themselves, and they model it. The child sees it. Have you ever told your child how you failed on the job? Rhetorically speaking. I revealed that recently to my children for this purpose, a little late. I mean, my oldest are 27. But the idea was I needed to make sure that they know that I fail. Because kids won't assume that. And knowing that failure is a part of success is something that's very helpful to their well-being psychologically. Personality, there are certain kinds of personalities that lend themselves a little more to this type of perfectionism than others. These kind of kids tend to be pretty good in school early, and they have successes that lead to aspirations for other successes. They start setting high standards for themselves. The communicative parents help them learn to set their own standards, as opposed to relying exclusively on grades, for example. Does that make sense? It's a different way of parenting. So they become motivated to achieve. They're in school to achieve. They want to test their mettle. They are motivated to do well. They want to be the top student. They'll sometimes plan the entire semester the first week. Have you ever known students who do that? Get like a planner, take the syllabus, map things out. My firstborn did that through college, through high school through college. He was a top student at a residential high school for gifted kids, top student in college. He wanted to be the top student. It was important to him to be the top student. He asked his professor in college, could he have a minute with his classmates alone? There were a total of about 10 or 12 students in his class. Professor left. My son said to his class, you know, I'm really disappointed in you all. You're not working hard enough, and it's detracting from my education. Surprisingly, that son is a fairly popular guy. He actually is well-liked by a lot of people, but he's very serious about his learning, and he puts a lot into it. Now, some of the cool things about this type of perfectionism, high performance, but what happens when they don't succeed? Because no one always succeeds, right? Unless you're setting the bar extremely low. So when he fails, when this type of perfectionists fail, they take a step back and they look at their work and they say, wow, I must not have gone about preparing for this well enough. I'm going to need to change these kinds of things. They don't question their abilities. They don't cast aspersions on the teacher. They look at how they approached it, make a decision about maybe changing it in the future. When they have success, they're proud. They own it. Wow, I worked hard at this. Look at the outcome. Hooray for me. What's next? That's this type of perfectionist. These people lead healthy lives. They tend to be top-performing people. There's not necessarily inordinate stress, although there is some stress because they bring it on themselves. It isn't their parents making them to do it, nor are they looking at society and feeling like society only loves them if they're this kind of perfectionist. It's nothing like that. A good dose of gifted kids have this kind of perfectionism. Not all, though. A second type is called socially prescribed. And this is the kind of perfectionism that we kind of used to think it was, this one type, where a student comes to believe that the world only cares for them as it relates to their performance as being a student. A lot of gifted kids feel this way. I have a lot of friends my age who feel this way, who grew up feeling this way. They're never accomplished enough. They never have enough awards. They never feel fulfilled. What does their family look like? The structure. All right, they tend to come from families with very restricted communications, unidirectional, monologues, do this, do that. It could be take the garbage out at 3, sit down, do your homework, don't get up till you're finished. Declarative statements, as opposed to the other parenting style that might be, how much time do you think you need for your homework tonight? Where do you think would be a good place for you to do it? Do you need some help from me? See the difference? Engagement, the child's put in a position to learn how to make decisions about quality. In this case, it's the opposite. It's relying on others to impose the quality standards. The parent, a parent, adult figure, tends to be perfectionistic, tends to model this. Pretty strong perceived expectations. And it's pretty commonly there, frankly. Now, this person grows up from a little bitty critter to a young adult, tying their self-worth to their performance in school. This leads to what we call in psycholand insecure attachment. The person doesn't grow up feeling like my relationship with my parents is a lifetime. It's, gosh, I hope I do well on this next test. So what motivates them? They're constantly fearing disappointing other people. So what motivates them? They are motivated to avoid failure. Now you might think, well, geez, are many people really motivated to avoid failure? Yes, many of our highest achieving people in all sorts of different professions. An interview with Jane Fonda, after she'd won an Academy Award, she said that she figures that roughly half of the great actors who she personally knows are motivated to, just driven to avoid failure in their craft. That's interesting, isn't it? At that level, you wouldn't necessarily assume that to be the case. So, how do these students live in our schools? One of the things they try to do is avoid being evaluated. So they procrastinate, put things off. Now, there are other ways and reasons for putting things off, but in this case, it's for that reason. They avoid challenges, take easier courses. Particular problem among our gifted females in mathematics. Take AB calculus rather than BC. Don't risk a B grade. Now, what happens when they perform and they don't fare well? They internalize it. It creates self-doubt in themselves, and they'll say things like, I told you I wasn't gifted. In other words, I'm an imposter because I didn't do a quiz one day well. You know, maybe you're 17 years old and you have 11 school years of success and you take a 10-item quiz that you don't fare well on and you doubt your whole history as an able person. That's how these kids experience their lives. It's hard. So when they don't perform well, it casts doubt on all their abilities and their future. And when they do perform well, they devalue it. They'll say, oh, well, that test was easy, or that teacher has low standards. Now, one of the games these students play that is one of the ways I find them is they'll wait till the 12th hour to do an assignment. With the reasoning be, but they won't tell you this, but the reasoning is often, it won't really put me in an awkward position of how well I could do because I only gave myself such a short period of time to do it. Maybe it was an assignment that was 4 weeks out and they do it the night before. So now all of a sudden, for some gifted kids, they do that to make a non-challenging assignment challenging. But for this type of perfectionism, they do it because they don't want to be measured anymore. They don't want to have an assessment. And if it's only a half day's work, it doesn't really reflect much. Have you ever known anybody who behaves like either of these two groups? I bet some of us in this room do little things that are along these lines. I won't point fingers or name names. Okay, but there's one more type of perfectionism. It's called other-oriented. This one's interesting. You know, as families, we acculturate our children to our family values. It can be as fun and banal as teaching kids how to behave on an elevator, right? There's elevator comportment. What are some of the behaviors we expect on elevators? Okay. Keep going. Quiet. Don't jump. Hold the door open. No eye contact. Keep your distance. Well, we can go on and on. There are a few more. Don't push all the buttons. Everybody face the same direction. Look at the numbers. On and on. And I can tell you, if you're a guy who looks like me, you ought to watch people dance when I get on the elevator. If I'm the only guy on the elevator, if there's one person, you'll be amazed at how wide an elevator can be. If there are two people and we move to our triangular position, which is required when you have three people on an elevator in the U.S., I'm always furthest afield. When I used to teach a course in social psychology, we used to do an experiment with an elevator, and we'd put the most cherubic-looking graduate student, it was always male, so very childlike, very sweet, innocent-looking. He was our Confederate, and we'd put him on an elevator, but we'd wait until the elevator got crowded on the first floor. So everybody's packed in there, trying not to touch each other, right? Looking straight ahead, hoping against hope that nothing happens that would, you know, reflect some major faux pas. So we'd put our Confederate on the second floor, and his only task was he'd get on the elevator and stand facing the group. So are you with me? He would just stand there and smile. He wouldn't talk to anybody, he wouldn't touch anybody. But you ought to see how people react to such a social faux pas as that. They'd ride up the elevator a few floors, he'd get off without fail. Somebody would lean out or step out and watch him go down a hall. And then either that person or someone else would say something along the lines of, wasn't that creepy? Now, by definition, that group has become a bonded group. So from an anthropological point of view, they need to form a reunion group that gets back together and re-experiences this traumatic event. Our society, like any society, is made up of differing expectations for different locations, contexts. That's part of the process. This type of perfectionism, in my opinion, is naturally born out of that. So now what you're doing is you're not criticizing yourself for holding your feet over the fire. You're looking at everybody else and pointing a finger at them and being critical of them for not living up to your standards, whatever your standards are. It could be religious standards, it could be academic standards, it could be apparel, you know, whatever you choose. Okay, at least three types of perfectionism. Very operative, active, not only in the gifted community, but in general. All right. A little bit about suicide. I know I'm running close on time, so I want to have to push it along here. And do, by the way, as I said before, if any of this interests you and you'd like to have more information, we have all sorts of research on these things. I'd be happy to share any of it with you at any time. If you ever are in Williamsburg, you want to come by and visit, give me a call and we'll give you a little tour, show you what we're up to. Here's the world's most basic model of suicide ideation, suicidal behavior. Suicide ideation, how prevalent is it? It's extremely prevalent, extremely present. As a matter of fact, I would say that across a person's lifetime, most people have thought at least one time about something to do with suicide. Now, does that mean it's likely to occur? No, it does not. Not at all. Among that huge group, what do we see? We see attempts. And we see several attempts made for any completion. And for females, it's about 3 to 5 times as many attempts per completion as males, depending upon which subgroup you want to consider. Now, I'm talking in this case 15 to 24-year-olds. Is there, among our age group of 15 to 24-year-olds, is there a national sort of epidemic? No, there's not. Of the 7 age groups that we study, suicidal behavior, that age group is lowest, they're the 3rd and 7, so they're slightly below half in the order. The most highest percentage of suicides, prevalence rates, are right now my age group and the most elderly. Then it comes to the group in between, then it comes down to one group, then it comes down to the 15 to 24. Thank goodness the lowest is the below 15. So, it's important, it's serious, it's incredibly important, but we're not seeing the kinds of national epidemic rates that you might think. This is a very simple model to show what I consider to be what goes on in suicidal behavior that leads to a completion. The top circle oval shape is us living our life. You know, we're living it above ground, meaning somewhat precariously. We do. We're people. And most of our life is spent up there, and we do quite well. And things occur in our life. Say if we're an adult and there's a divorcing situation or a relationship breakup or a passing of a parent or something, you know, a really tough, tragic, hard event, it knocks our at a kilter a little bit. It's hard for us. It takes us a while to recover, but we usually do. And so we're back up there, having our life, leading, doing things. Now there are things that affect us, and some of those things are positive things. There are protective factors in terms of mental health that keep us going. And then there are risk factors. There are environmental factors. There are biological factors. So let's say we've had a series of things that tend to correlate with suicidal behavior. Number one most common thing, you're probably aware of this, is what we call a comorbidity, like depression, most common. There are also others that are very common, like anxiety. But depression's almost always there. So let's say a person is in a long-term, somewhat severe depression. And let's say a relationship breaks up. And let's say he or she starts medicating with alcohol or other form of drugs that are sort of depressants. They're coming down the circle now. They're starting this slow descent. And it's usually pretty slow, frankly. And there are things in society that have been built in and that are naturally occurring that can help. family interventions, a teacher becoming aware, a minister, all these different, usually people related, and quite often that's as far as it gets. We do things, we help, the person makes their way back up and they do okay. In this case, we're going to say it didn't happen, they're still coming down. In this case, let's say it's a 16-year-old person. What are other things that might affect it? Now, I can tell you William & Mary is a place that has a concern about suicide among its students and has for some time. And I'm told that there's a reputation that William & Mary has to that end. And I can tell you that in the past 12 months, we've had 4 suicides among the student body. Now, to me, that's 4 too many. So we are doing a lot at William & Mary, both to research it and also to stop it. But there are things like previous attempts that no one ever knows about, because quite often you can't ask those questions and you certainly aren't going to report them in the news. So one of the things I would just ask you to do for your own well-being, but also others, is when you come across a story about a suicide, be cautious about interpreting if it's in the newspaper, say, because seldom do what they put in the newspaper prove to be very accurate. They just don't have access to the important factors that led up to it. Well, there's some wonderful researchers. Well, my favorite is a man named either Schneidman or Schneidman. I've never figured out exactly how to say it, but he's done seminal work on this. And he talks about psychache, and he talks about hopelessness. That's sort of shown by that little cloud there. That if you get to that place in your life with those other factors and you've got that downward momentum, there's not much that's going to slow you down from that point. If there's not an intervention pretty fast, it's going to be too late. And then there are other factors that can influence it. So I wanted to say just a couple of pieces about this, because you can play a major role in helping. First, you're not going to cause suicide. So get that out of your mind. Doesn't work that way. By saying it doesn't make it more likely to occur. Now that's something we all fret about. What if the person wasn't thinking about it? You're saying it is not going to increase the likelihood of occurring. So what do I do? How do I intervene? There's somebody I'm worried about. Well, that's another piece of advice I'd give you. Unless you're a highly trained clinical psychologist or psychiatrist on this, you're not in a position to judge if a person is on the brink of attempting a suicide. That's not the standard you should hold for yourself. You know, as a thoughtful person, caring person, when you see a person in distress, right? I bet every one of you can tell. Well, you can feel confident. You can tell when another person's feeling distress. That's your level. That's your threshold. Now, what do? You don't psychoanalyze them. You talk to them, you show them concern, you show them care, you ask them a couple of questions. How are they doing? You're worried about them, it's okay for you to say that. Are you thinking this way? And then I suggest to people that you literally and figuratively, you put your arm around them and you walk them to see a counselor. Unless you're a trained professional, get them to a person who is. Now, us doing that as a collective will have an effect. We are in the midst of a psychological autopsy right now. This is our 5th. We've published 4 others. We've learned a lot by doing them. We've also done some research, a fair amount, on what's called suicide ideation, the thinking about suicide. While the prevalence rates for high-ability kids and the general population can't be parsed out, I can't tell you if it's the same or different. People claim both. There's not enough evidence to say either way. So I'm assuming that it's relatively the same. But here's what I'm worrying about. As a person whose career has become focused on suicide among high-ability kids, what I worry about is I fear that they have fewer attempts per completion. And the reason I've gotten to this is based on an N of 5, okay? So keep that in mind. But we've had the journals of kids who have planned out and carried out their suicides, and they were so likely to be successful based on the planning that it wasn't like other types or examples where there can be an element of a spur of the moment, you know, where a person's gotten to a certain place where they attempt. These were very mindful, planned out actions that had a very, you know, perfect success rate. So that's what's worrying me. Because when you're trying to keep people alive, time is your coin of the realm. Any time you can buy that person increases the likelihood of them continuing. So in our roles as caregivers, as concerned adults, let's just look for people in distress. Let's get them help. Don't worry, you're not going to cause it. Let me show you this. A nurse, a friend of mine who asked me to do a, we became friends. She was a nurse and her son killed himself, gifted kid. We spent 4 years studying his life. His name's Reed Ball. I've agreed to always mention his name for there are issues of stigma associated with suicidal behavior. And part of eliminating that is to talk about the person. So she asked me to always mention his name. His name is Reed Ball. Well, Reed passed away some years ago, and we studied his life, came up with some very important conclusions, I think, and she shared this with me. This was used widely in Canada, and it lists both protective factors and contributing factors to suicidal behavior. And what I want you to notice is, I bet if you'll take an inventory in your own family, you'll see that, in fact, there are many good things that you have within your grasp that are already operative as protective factors. And I would say accentuate those. And if you can develop them more, please do. One of the simplest and yet hardest to bring about is that communication factor within the family that I talked about. Relationships among teenagers and them breaking, if the child is already showing depression or other issues, is something to be concerned about. If a person ever says they're thinking about suicide, that's all you need to hear. You don't need to make a quality judgment as to whether it's likely to occur. Just assume the distress and try to help them get help. And in virtually every case that there's a suicide, evidence leading up to it is found in the aftermath. It's just not always seeable to the right people. Now, one thing I learned, I was in charge of the residential high school for gifted kids for 9 years, and I came in at the heels of 3 suicides. And we did the postvention and we did the research, and then I was at that school, and there's not been a suicide in 15 or 16 years at that school, which we're very thankful for, because of some things we put into place, some policy differences, some behavioral differences, some attitudinal differences. At that time, the students at that school said, in no uncertain terms, we'd rather have a dead friend than a live enemy. That the social angst associated with outing a person for having a mental health struggle was so great at that location at that time that the kids weren't coming forward. The kids often know, and the adults seldom know. At that school, kids knew, adults didn't know. So we had to change that dynamic. So one of the things I'd ask you to do is enlist the help of your students. They've got to feel like coming forward is safe. Safe for them, safe for their friends. If they do that, they're going to come forward. Because if you rely exclusively on the adults, it's a little hit or miss. Even with caring, thoughtful, perceptive people. So if you engage them both, your chances really go up for success. So, and that's why I'm here. I think very highly of this school district. It really puts its money where its mouth is. It's trying its best to build that caring community where people like yourselves contribute to the well-being of all the students. This is a high-performing place. There's always going to be stress around being a student. Why? Because you got so many good ones, and so many aspirations, and so many expectations, and perfectionism. You've got so many kids who want to make their families proud. You've got financial conditions that have changed within a lifetime that makes going to college so much more difficult. All that's happening at the same time. Add drugs, add alcohol, add relationships, add maturational differences for gifted kids, all these different factors, and you think, wow, it's really complicated. It's really very hard to be a gifted child here and now. What can we do to help them? Well, coming here was a really good step. A few things. I'm not going to lecture these things. I just want to show you a few. First and foremost, model what it is that's important. If talking is important, you've got to show it. Don't expect it without showing it. And it's going to be uncomfortable because if you're not, you're going to hear from your children some issues that maybe you're not accustomed to talking about. If you can do that, you're creating that caring community. You know where most of our kids pick up their stress? It's vicarious learning. They're looking around the environment and they're hearing what people are saying, and it isn't limited to school by any means. It's their friendship base. It might be friends at church. It might be what they see on TV. All this is contributing to this generalized anxiety and the stress that comes from it. And it's chronic. And then we do things inadvertently as parents without knowing it that really just pushes them over the edge sometimes. Sometimes our kids hear that going to college isn't enough, that it can only be one or two of these colleges. Well, that's your call as a family. But let me tell you, that has an effect. So I would encourage you to think hard about what goals you convey to your children, because they're going to start hearing them before they're adults. They're going to be hearing your expectations when they're that little bitty person. That's why I gave you that example of my daughter. We conveyed one thing. She heard something quite different. It took years for us to ever know that she had internalized something we never said. So for yourselves, if you would think about that, maybe do a review from time to time, you can really help out. My wife told me about a teacher who told her about a parent who told her that the primary role of families is to counter culture. Now, I'm of a generation where we talk about counterculture in a very different way. In this case, this is a goal. A couple of quick examples, and then we'll have to wrap up. Oh, my. United States is one of the few countries in the world that allow our young girls to be sexualized objects. Why in the hell we do that? I have no idea. But we do. Well, that's an element that maybe we ought to rethink. Maybe seven-year-olds don't need to be paraded away around that way. All sorts of ways in which we genderize. Some of them probably are neutral, but that one's not. And that's about that may be one of those elements of countering culture. You need to know if your child is basically an extrovert or an introvert. Where do they get their energy? Where do they get tired? That's going to lead you down different pathways of understanding them and doing things on their behalf. There's a slightly higher rate of suicidal ideation among introverted gifted kids, which means you're not as likely to hear about it either. And that's part of the conundrum for us. So, I'm running out of time, as I always do, and I never have good endings. So, let me do this. I am sincere in my desire to help you raise your children to be happy, healthy, productive people. I have some resources at my end, and I'm absolutely committed to sharing them with you. We live a little far apart, but 2 hours and 20 minutes this morning. But I'm happy to say, with the internet and everything else, I would be happy to share with you research on any of these kinds of topics that you're interested in. I can't help you with other topics. I don't know much about them. I'm not interested in them. One thing nice about being an endowed chair, I don't have to be interested in them. This is what I'm interested in. So it's been a real treat for me to get a chance to come up here and visit with you. Please, let's work together. And send us a note and let us know how we can help you, okay? Thank you very much.
For more information about the Community Keynote Series, please visit the Fairfax Network website.